So good morning, good evening to all of you, those who are joined this particular call. And again, once again, thank you Bapatla College inviting me for giving my thoughts. One of the topic is called FDA's 505B2 drug approval process. This topic I have selected, thinking lots on that, why I should select this particular topic. I'll just give you little bit overview. I have worked last 20 years in Indian pharmaceutical industry in various international research center. So I know very closely the way India works, considering the changing in the scenario, changing in the requirements. This 505B2 drug approval process is very, very important for Indian pharmaceutical fraternity. The reasons I am telling that, you people all know that India contribute close to 40% of pharmaceutical products for world requirements. That means India is the major player of supporting healthcare globally. So maybe many of you, those who have joined this particular call, you know that how India contributed, and the COVID situations also give more clarity how important India is for supplying medicines across the globe. Staying in Canada last 3 years, I know that once this COVID situation arises, how badly other countries are requiring medicines, they do not have capacity and capability either to develop or manufacture. So now the importance of India becomes more and more for developing the pharmaceutical products. And this particular forum, as many of you, those who are the faculty for the pharmaceutical and pharmacy college, and the you peoples are the major contributor to create the talent for the pharma industries. So knowing that, so the topic I have selected I'll go through that how important this particular 505 to drug approval process for the pharmaceutical industries in India. And the next slides I'm going, this is something I always put it, because this presentation represents my personal opinion and does not necessarily represent the opinion of my company I work, Apotex, or a view or policy of any pharmaceutical regulatory agencies. Purely what I'll talk it today, it will be my personal opinion on that. So the topic I'm going to cover here, I'll give you a little bit introductions about the 505B2 process, and why it needs and what is its purpose. Then I'll go through the comparisons of the different regulatory pathway for putting the drug application to the FDA. And then I'll go to the specific to the 505B2 application. Then the different kind of application submitted under 505B2. So what we can't submit under the 505B2, and if you are submitting, what are the patent and exclusivity rights you are going to get it? What should be included in 505B2? Then is there any legal controversy of submitting this particular application? I'll go through a case study. Then the last, I'll give you the benefits of that. The first things, the introductions, slides. We all know that Federal Food and Drug Cosmetics Act, in which sections 505 of the act describe three different types of new drug applications. We all know the 70 to 75% resources we use in Indian pharmaceutical industries developing the product for the US market. So when we develop a product for the US market, so there are three different type of applications we need to submit to the agencies, and based on that applications, agents will review and give the approval. The first application is called 505B1. What is that applications? The applicant create a dossier or the full informations of the investigational product, where they put all the safety and effectiveness of the product. That means, so if you are developing a product, starting from the dose selections, dose range study, phase one, phase two, phase three, all the informations put together, developing a product and apply for the approval to the agencies through the application is called 505B1. So another application is called 505B2. This is the topic of discussions today. These applications that contains full report of investigations of safety and effectiveness, but where at least some of the information required for this particular application is not necessarily to generate or create by the applicant. This particular informations applicant can refer from some other applications. So if you need not, I am audible. Hello.
Yes, sir. Okay. You are audible.
Yeah. Okay. So, this particular application, so what we are going to talk at 505B2, you need not to generate the whole bunch of information. The part of information you can collect or you can refer from the other applications. The particular application is called 505B2. The third application, an application that contains information to show that the proposed product is identical in active ingredient, dosage form, strength, route of administration, labeling, quality, and performance characteristics of the product, and also the same intended use, among the other things, to a previously approved product, that is called 505J. In another term, we call as ANDA, abbreviated new drug applications. Most of our Indian research center, Indian pharmaceutical organizations, they work on the 505J. Very rarely, maybe less than 5% of their resources goes towards the 505B2, and 505B1 hardly less than 1%. This is a completely called as a new drug application for the NC. So till today, again, the other words, till today, the Indian pharma industry is only focused towards the 505J, it's called ANDA. The 505B applications is one of the three type of NDA that can be submitted to the FDA. A full NDA is an application that contains full reports of investigations of safety and effectiveness according to the 505B1. But the NDA, which contains everything, starting from your discovery of the molecules to the end study, like the phase 3 study, but an abbreviated ANDA, like the one drug already approved in US and patent is going to be expired, and most of the Indian company, they want to start the generic versions of that product, is called as ANDA. They need not to go for doing all sort of clinical trial. Only the bioavailability or bioequivalence study is sufficient to submit that application. But in case of 505B2, it is called as a hybrid form of NDA and ANDA, in which you need not to go for generating the complete set of data like NDA, but you are going to get the advantages of exclusivity as well as the patentability if you are developing the product through 505B2. Why I'm stressing that particular point, 505B2? If historically, if we see the Indian pharmaceutical industry's research, they develop the product, one called as ANDA, and second set of product they develop for the India market is called the branded generics. We develop different generics product, but we put it in a brand name and it's called as a branded generic. So branded generic is the midpoint of ANDA and 505B2. This branded generics products, they develop not in a very systematic manner, but they develop product, they have the know-how, and they know how to develop this product, they have all this capability, but these products they develop for only for the India market. I'll go through the couple of slides why it is very, very important for the Indian pharmaceutical industries, and also for the faculty, those who are present here, when they teach their students, and how they are going to teach them that why this 505B2 process is important when the students, after completions of their graduations or post graduation, they will enter into the pharma industries. Their focus will be how to develop the 505B2 products. So why it is the need? So when we want to develop a NDA, like the new chemical entity, It is a skyrocketing R&D cost. It takes close to minimum 2 to 3 billion US dollar for developing a new chemical entity. Time consuming clinical trial. It takes near about 10 years, more than 10 years to bringing a new chemical entity into the market. Then you are not going to get the very long patent exclusivity. The day you file a patent, you will get 18 to 20 years for the patent exclusivity. The day you develop the product and the product getting to the market, almost 10 to 15 years already gone. Hardly you will get 4 to 5 years remaining this particular patent exclusivity. Then within 5 years time, when the patent is expiring, lot of a generics player will enter into the market. So you invested 15 years to 20 years time to developing a product, and when you are putting the product in the market, hardly you will have only few years to enjoy that particular exclusivity. Then once this patent gets expired, lot of generic player enter into the market. You will create the market, and the generic player will take that particular market share. Then the uncertainty at every stage. You do not know. You are going to spend it for 10 to 15 years. You do not know what will be the success rate. The, till today, the success rate of NC is not more than 5%. That means if 100 molecules, they are discovering hardly 5 molecules getting the day of light coming to the market. That means 95% uncertainty is there if you are developing a NC. Coming to the ANDA. So ANDA, once the patent get expired, everybody has a rights to develop the generic versions of that particular molecule and enter into the market. But huge competitions. The India and China, suppose one molecule patent is getting expired today, tomorrow you will find close to 20 to 25 applications submitted to the FDA. FDA is giving the approval to everybody in a single day. So that means huge competitions. Whatever the product you will develop, you may not get the good profit on this. Then the regulatory hurdles, the registrations of the product, and the lot of exercise you have to do because of the so many applicants are applying for that particular product approval. There will be a long waiting time. Nowadays for getting an ANDA approval, taking around 14 to 18 months time. So nowadays, as I explained you, the declining in the NDA over the recent year. I'll show you some graph in my next slides. That how the NDA approval is declined day by day. The reason that the huge cost, the success rate is very low. So many companies, instead of focusing on the NDA, they started focusing on the 505B2. Now the number of product approval on 505B2 route is more than the new drug applications. So the purpose is the 505B2 application is intended to encourage the sponsor to develop a innovative medicines using currently available product. Here, this point I want to emphasize that innovator develop the product, create the market. You need not to waste your time and resources to create the market for that molecule. But what you are going to do, you are going to develop some sort of innovations product on that particular molecule and enjoy the market share, markets developed by the innovator companies. So this particular rules created in 1984 as part of the Hatch-Waxman Amendment Act. So if someone develops some sort of innovations in the existing molecule, either in different route of administrations or the different indications, and they are eligible for the getting this particular exclusivity according to the sections 505B2 guidelines. And NDA approval through 505B2 can be obtained for a new drug without conducting the full complaint of safety and efficacy trial. So in that particular 1984 Hatch-Waxman amendment works, if you are using the existing molecule, improving the efficacy or creating the new drug delivery systems or identify the new indications for that particular molecule, you need not to go for doing the full-fledged clinical trial which will take you 4 to 5 years, thousands of human volunteers. You need to do only specific study instead of going for the full-fledged clinical trial. That is the main advantages of this particular 505B2 route. I'll give you you might have known that. I'll give one simple example that Bholini spray, which contains diclofenac diethyl amine spray form. Initially, it was available in ointment or a gel form. When the same molecule, we are developing route of administration is topical, but the dosage form is different. Instead of gel into the spray, that is called the 505B2 product. So you need not to go for doing all this safety toxicity study for that product, and you are improving the delivery system. Instead of gel, you are going for the spray form. This is the example I thought of to share with you for the better understanding. That is called the 505B2 products. Here is the graph. You will see I put from 2003 to 2019. Okay. The number of 505B2 approval, 2018 is the year where 75 505B2 product approved by FDA. If you see the right hand side figure, the 505B1 approval means the NC versus 505B2. 38% if NC is getting approved out of 100 product, 56% is the 505B2 approvals. It means that even if agency is also focusing to give more approval on 505B2 product, what is the reasons? There are very, very valid reasons on that. The reason that suppose few years back when innovator develop a product, they develop the tablet dosage form. Maybe 10 years back, that times the technology was not that advanced. And they have done all the safety and efficacy studies. They are encouraging that use that safe molecules, which is already proven for the safety and efficacy, create a new dosage form for the improved efficacy of the product. That is called 505B2. So if you are using the same molecule, you need not to go for doing the same type of safety and efficacy study using the either healthy volunteers or patient. The second important reason, there is no reasons of exposing the human volunteers for the same drug again and again without any reasons. So, and the third thing is most important thing is you need not to spend unnecessarily this much of resources and time, and which ultimately increase the cost of the product. So, the 505B2 is one of the best approach of improving the efficacy of the existing molecule or creating the new delivery system for the existing molecule, so that and your development cost will be minimum, and you need not to give exposure this particular drug to the human beings through different clinical trials. Coming back to see what are the delivery system mostly developing this 505B2 routes. Most of the products, 42% are injectables. I'll give an example, like maybe some injectables are there as called as simple solutions. Okay. And same molecules, people started developing as a control release injectables instead of giving every day, once in a week dosage form, once in a month dosage form, or targeted drug delivery like liposome, microspheres. These are called the 505B2. If simple solutions were there, they can redevelop within the same molecule in different dosage form. Similar way, in case of nasals, suppose for example, we are using the tablet, sumatriptan. They use as a sumatriptan tablet. They come up with a sumatriptan nasal. Or for example, like we have only single components like azelastins, as a single nasal spray, fluticasone is a single nasal spray. We come up with the combinations, azelastins and fluticasone combinations called 505B2. Similarly, ophthalmic. Earlier, we used to have only solution form of ophthalmic. Now the microemulsions, nanoemulsions ophthalmic coming up, so which improve the efficacy, reduce the toxicity, and you need not to you do go for the full phase of clinical trial because you are using the existing molecule. So almost all delivery systems, you talk about ophthalmic, topical, nasal, oral, injectables, there is a scope of developing 505(b)(2) in all dosage forms. The approval type, if you see the type of approval, new formulations or collagen, the new manufacturer, 45% of the approval on this 505(b)(2) route coming in the new formulations. For example, like if you have, as I talk about the ophthalmic, you have, for example, brimonidine simple solutions you have. You can develop the brimonidine nanoemulsion. So you created the new formulations. So 45% of the product getting approval through 505(b)(2) as a new formulations, new dosage form, if something tablets forms are there, maybe transdermal, sublingual patch, something like that, new dosage form, maybe you have ointment, it can be developed as a spray, or it was in tablet, it can be developed in nasal spray. So 25% of the 505(b)(2) on the existing molecules coming as a new dosage form. New combinations. India is the pioneer of developing the combinations product. So even if that type of expertise, experience, we can extend it to develop in a systematic way for the US market in 505(b)(2). So lot of combinations therapy we can go through the 505(b)(2). New molecular entity in the different polymorphic form. Suppose one form is already patent protected, you are not able to develop the same form as NDA, you can go for the different the polymorphic form. Or maybe new active ingredient, again the similar way the form. Then already marketed products, some products which are already marketed, maybe you are improving the efficacy of the product or reducing the toxicity, around 2% of the product also getting 505(b)(2). As a whole, what I mean to communicate to Ipopol, that 505(b)(2) is one of the promising route of developing the product for the US market or the global market. I'll just give the comparisons of the pathway, like 505(1) applications, and 505(b)(2) and 505(j), B1, B2, and J. See, if you are developing a NC with respect to the regulatory process, agency meeting, if you are developing a 505(b)(2), you will get a chance to meet, have a pre-NDA meeting with the agencies. They will allow you to go for a requesting a meeting, but NDA, you are not going to do that. User fee, yes, obviously you are going to pay the user fee. And review classifications, this will be taken on the priorities review. If you are coming up with some unique delivery system to improve the quality of life or improve the efficacy of the product, and your review process will be classified, and your priorities review can be taken. And nowadays, on average, we found that 9 to 10 months is taking for getting approval in 505(b)(2). So here you have to provide the full report, like the NDA applications with all the safety and efficacy. It need not be, you need to generate this. You can refer many reports from the other filing, but your submissions should contain the full report. PK, bioavailability and biochemical study, yes. You have to do the all these pharmacokinetics, bioavailability and biochemical study with RLD, referring the existing molecule where the dosage forms are available. That could be your reference to prove the safety, at least for the safety. Efficacy, you may or may not refer to the RLD, but for the safety point of view, you need to refer the RLD with respect to the drug absorptions into the blood. CMC bridging study, yes, this is required because you need not to go for doing the full-fledged clinical trials. You have to refer some of the information from the RLD, and you need to go for some bridging study. Supporting publications on RLD, yes, you are allowed to, instead of generating the data, you can refer a lot of publications and put that information in your dossier, saying that this is the published either by agencies or by any journals, and this data will be acceptable. FDA's finding on safety and efficacy, if agencies created some information or finding, you can also refer that documents and put in your file. Examples of allowed change, yes, new molecular entity is allowed. You can go for different morphic form or hydrate form. and a new active moiety. Yes, it is also allowed for the 505(b)(2). New indications, if you found that same molecules can be used for some other purpose and file your applications in 505(b)(2), that is allowed. New route of administrations, yes. New formulations also, yes, you can use it. New ester, new salt, or new non-covalent derivatives, that is allowed if you know that this particular new salt or new ester is the pharmaceutically active. It is allowed for developing the 505(b)(2), new dosage form, even if the new strength and combinations product. Similarly, switching the prescription to OTC also considered as a 505(b)(2). And also the labeling, if you have some different labeling, different indications, that also allowed on that. Marketing and patent issue. Here the important things I need to say to here. Like the 505(b)(1), the new chemical entity, if you are developing 505(b)(2), the existing molecule, existing marketed molecules, you can also get the patent extensions for your innovations, like what the new dosage form, new indications, or new formulations. That is most important here. In NDA, you are not going to get that patented. May or may not be. If you are exactly copying the reference product, you may not get the patent. Here, the marketing exclusivity. ANDA, you are not going to get the marketing exclusivity. It's very uncertain. If you are lucky, you can get market share in ANDA. But here in 505(b)(2), depending upon your type of study, type of indications, you will get the exclusivity minimum 3 years, maximum 7 years. I will explain to you in couple of my next slides. So here in this particular slide, say you that if you are developing the 505(b)(2), data generations minimum, approval time first, advantages is more. So if we are creating that type of talent and resources, it will give lot of benefit to our pharmaceutical industries for developing this 505(b)(2) products. 505(b)(2) applications. 505(b)(2) applications is one of which one or more of the investigations relied upon by the applications for approval. Not necessarily you need to generate or create, you can refer these applications. So these applications can rely on the published literature. If particular informations, the research has been done or the finding done in some university or academics or some of the different study, they found the some of the information they published, you can refer to that. You need not to prove again. If it is a published literature, are there. If you are developing a 505(b)(2), I'll give an example. For example, that very recently, Dr. Reddy's developed one product is called sumatriptan nasal spray. First absorbing sumatriptan nasal spray. So this particular dosage form, it will give you the bioavailabilities or the pharmacokinetics profiles faster than the current nasal spray. They developed that particular product and they found that some of the excipient which has a property of the faster absorptions of that particular molecule, especially for the migraine patient, they need the drug response as fast as possible. So it is not necessary that you have to prove that particular absorption profile through your drug. If some literature are saying that you can use that particular information in your product. And agencies finding, sometimes by agency by their own, for the long-term safety purpose, they do lot of study. If agency also finding with respect to the safety and effectiveness of the approved drug, so you can use that information. So it is giving the added advantages for the 505(b)(2) that if somebody else have generated some data, you can use that information for your advantages when you are developing the 505(b)(2) product. Different kind of applications submitted under the 505(b)(2), as I described earlier, you can go for the new chemical entity for the 505(b)(2) or the changes to the previously approved drug, maybe the changing the dosage form, changing the strength, changing the route of administration, and the substitutions of the active ingredient in combinations product. For example, like you have atorvastatin. single molecule. If you are combining with ultrasound plus clopidogrel, so you can apply through the 505(b)(2) as a combination product. Again, the new formulations, suppose you have immediate release tablet, and if you are developing the control release tablet in the same molecule, and that can be applied through the 505(b)(2). Active ingredient in different salt, different ester, chelate, complex. So if you are identifying that different salt like omeprazole, calcium, magnesium salt, they're using nowadays through the 505(b)(2). Again, the combinations product, as I told earlier, the nowadays a lot of combinations products are coming up, and a lot of other companies, they started developing the 505(b)(2). If that particular combination is not available, and this is the easiest way of the innovation. So you know that the single components are there, and these two combinations have the advantages of particular therapy. And if that unique combinations you can identify, it could be a 505(b)(2). Switching from Rx to OTC, so that could be also another way of applying for the 505(b)(2) application. What CANS submitted under the 505(b)(2). I want to put it here that when you are developing some product, even though it says that you can change your strength, you can change your dosage form, some of the things FDA indicated here that you can't submit this particular information under the 505(b)(2). And applications in which only difference from the reference listed drug is that the extent to which the active ingredient is absorbed or otherwise made available to the site of actions less than the listed drug. Suppose, for example, you find that I'll give one example like salbutamol inhaler, the drug concentrations for that particular product is 10 micrograms after one inhalation. You found that you develop one product, the drug absorption is 8 micrograms. Instead of 10, it is 8 micrograms. So you cannot claim that applications, which does not give any benefit on that, and you can't apply for that as a 505(b)(2). Similarly, in applications in which only difference from the reference listed drug is that the rate, the first one is the extent, second one is the rate. Suppose within 10 hours, the area under the curve or the concentrations of the drug available in a particular time period is less than the your product compared with the innovator product, you cannot claim that that's a 505(b)(2) application. That does not give any advantages. It's just one example I got up to share with you people. So here is the advantages page. If we are developing a 505(b)(2), where we need not to spend more time and more resources to establishing the safety and efficacy of that particular molecule, but we are able to developing a different dosage form. For example, earlier it was in the tablet, we develop a transdermal patch. Molecule is the same, drug delivery system is different, you are going to get the patent term extensions. Suppose for example, innovator has the product, they come up with a different delivery system, they are patently extended. If other generic company, they are not the innovator, they develop the different dosage from the same molecule, that company also going to get the patent extension. So if it is a new chemical entity, for example, you develop some different indications for a new chemical entity, you are going to get directly 5 years for the exclusive. No other company develop the same dosage form within that 5 year exclusive period. You can, innovator already created the market. You are putting the different delivery systems or the different route of administrations on the same molecule, and you are getting exclusivity for that molecule for the 5 year. The great advantages on that. With the first ANDA patent challenger, you are developing product, you are not exactly copying, you are challenging, you are going to get 180 days exclusivity. That paragraph 4, that most of the company, they try for that, the 180 days exclusivity. The new clinical investigation, for example, there is a pediatric exclusivity. The existing molecule, innovator did not do the study on the pediatric, you made the study on the pediatric, you will get the extensions of 3 more years. If it is orphan drug, this is a very rare disease. This particular molecule is going to be used for a very rare diseases, and you did some sort of innovations on that particular molecule, existing molecule, come up with something like the good efficacy or safety of that molecule, which is orphan drug. Directly, the company is going to get 7-year exclusivity. Again, for the existing molecule, for the pediatric new indications, pediatric is there, and you come up with another safety data on pediatric, you are going to get 6-month extra exclusivity on that. So I'll go through the little bit about the pediatric exclusivity, what exactly it is. The pediatric exclusivity, it extends any applicable patent or regulatory exclusivity by an additional of 6 months. Sponsor must conduct FDA requested pediatric study. Suppose you found that some of your initial investigations that this particular molecule can be used for the pediatric, and you requested to FDA that this is the initial investigations. I found that I want to go for the complete pediatric study. So FDA will request that, yes, you need to do the pediatric studies to get that 6-month exclusivity. So this pediatric study can also be supported for a 3 years in the new chemical entity exclusivity. What I explained to you earlier, if it is a new chemical entity where never done pediatric study, and that particular molecule, existing molecule, where the safety profiles already has been established, and you develop the pediatric dose for that, directly you are going to get 3-year exclusivity. Great, this is a big advantage. Orphan drug exclusivity, like I have explained to you, that if it is this particular molecule will be used for the rare diseases. Rare diseases means it affects only less than 200,000 persons in the US, or it affects more than 200,000 persons, but the profit margins from that molecule is not that great. So in that scenario, you are going to get 7-year exclusivity. No other company will be able to launch this particular dosage form or the product within 7 years. That is called orphan drug exclusivity criteria in 505(b)(2). Some of the exceptions allowing the FDA approve the second drug during the 7 years period. Some of the exceptions, suppose for example, somebody get the orphan drug exclusivity, but they cannot meet the requirement, they cannot supply. And somehow they stop supplying on that. In that scenario, they'll allow the other persons to develop this particular product and launch into the market. What should be included in 505(b)(2)? Again, I want to repeat that this is very important, I feel. So when you are developing a product and applying to the agency for 505(b)(2) route, what are the informations you must include in your applications? Identifications of those portions of the applications that may rely on the informations the applicant does not own. You must remember that when you are not going to generate the full set of informations for 505(b)(2), you should not ignore that some of the informations which is required for your applications for the reviewers. You need to gather all the information either from the source of information from the innovator product or the published literature. You cannot just put your applications what the data you have generated, because it required a complete application. Make sure that you are gathering the information available in the literature, available or done by the innovator company or done by the agencies, so that your application should be complete. If you are putting only the information you have generated, this is not called as a complete dossier. So make sure that as maximum as possible, you gathered all the information which is available in the public domain, which is called as a real world evidences approach. So in 505(b)(2), seek a relay on the agency's previous finding of safety and efficacy. When you are submitting your dossier, make sure that the same molecule, there are a lot of information generated by the agencies, and it will be easier for them to understand that, yes, these are the informations already agency is known, and the added information, generic company generated, and this is the added information which is the only added information required for them. But at least they know that all other information what you have included in your dossier is complete one. Information with respect to the any patent that claim the drug or use of the drug. Suppose you have developed a specific drug delivery systems which you need to claim a patent for that. When you are drafting the patent or filing the patent, that patent information needs to be given to them, because that patent also allow you to get the exclusivity. Information required if the applicant believe it is entitled to the marketing exclusivity. For example, like the pediatric exclusivity, orphan drug exclusivity, where you feel that this particular product you have generated the data and which requires the marketing exclusivity, your application should have all that information. Similarly, the patent certifications with respect to any relevant patent that claim the listed drugs. Suppose if you are infringing or you are claiming that you are not infringing that particular patent claimed by the other organizations, that information also you need to include in your applications. For completely new indications, so you have to put that this is the type of study you have done and claiming that this particular molecule is another new indications you are adding along with the existing indications, that information should be there. So similarly, the marketing exclusivity in the listed drugs, that needs to be included. BAB study comparing the proposed product to the listed drugs. So whatever the in vitro the bioequivalence and the bioavailability study you have done along with the reference product, that information should be available in your dossier. Study necessary to support the change or modifications made from the listed drugs, if any. Suppose, for example, in the listed drug, there are certain modification is required with respect to the frequency of administrations, or the any special instructions during the delivery drug delivery systems, or during delivering the drug into the human body. If some sort of changes is required or modifications required, that also you can include in your applications. Before submissions, when you want to submit your product, make sure that you are reaching out to the agencies like the CDR. So saying that if you need any type of bridging study or not, because sometimes you may feel that these informations already available or already done by the reference product, I may not go for any type of study, and you are not the right judge to decide. Before you submit, at least approach to the agencies, asking them, this is the applications I am going to submit. Is there any bridging study I need to do before I submit my applications? So that if you are submitting your applications, there will be a chances of refuse to file if the complete informations are not available. And the advantages of 505B2 process, agency, as per the agency's policy, if anybody wants to submit 505B2, they are allowed to request to the agency for either a meeting request, or they can communicate to the agency to get the clarifications. So submit a plan to the agencies. Also identify those components of its applications for which they expect to rely on FDA findings on the safety. So if you are thinking that you need to include some of the informations generated or studied by the agencies, you need to include them, that inform them in beforehand, before you submit, that these are the informations which I found agency already known to that, and for the reference purpose, we are going to include these informations in your applications. So definitely the divisions, they will review and they will give you their suggestions and the guidance for that also. So it is, sometimes you may find some sort of legal controversy. So I'll just give you a few examples on that. When FDA started allowing the 505B2 applications, Pfizer is the first company. They put the petitions against the FDA policy that you can't use the innovator information for the 505B2 applications. If anybody wants to generate the new data, this claiming for the 505B2 application, they should generate the complete information. So from Pfizer put the petitions, but obviously it denied by FDA. Similarly, I'll give one example. In case of amlodipine bisalate salt, the amlodipine bisalate amlodipine tablet developed by the Pfizer, when Dr. Reddy's developed their 505B2 in amlodipine maleate is the originator, and amlodipine bisalate is the 505B2. When they developed that particular product, that times also again Pfizer put the petitions against Dr. Reddy's, saying that Dr. Reddy's need to generate the complete data on their new salt instead of relying on the Pfizer's data. But FDA again denied that. Similarly, in case of Tarofarm petition against the Synthion's NDA, paroxetine mesylate, and RLD was the paroxetine hydrochloride, the same thing happens. So the history says that even you are using the RLD data, the clinical trial data for your 505B2 submissions, even the innovator filed the petitions, FDA is not going to accept their petitions. They are going to deny their petitions and they're going to give the approvals. I'll give one case study in case of one product is somatropin. This is a biologics product, the classic example. So how complex it was, even though innovator try to stop to give the FDA filing the petition so that FDA should not approve them, but finally FDA given them the approval. On July 30th, 2013, 2003, Sandoz submitted its Omnitrop, another 505B2, one molecule is called somatropin, against the genotropin of Pfizer molecules. So once they submitted the 505B2, Pfizer submitted the citizen petitions requesting to the FDA, this is a biologic molecules and FDA should not rely on the innovator data for giving the approval the 505B2 molecules. Pfizer say that it is not legally permit that FDA will refer all the informations generated by the Pfizer and using that informations for the safety and efficacy of another molecule developed by the Sandoz. Later on, there's another two companies, they also submitted the similar type of petitions and saying to FDA not to approve this particular 505B2 to Sandoz. At the end, so FDA decided that this particular molecule was developed by the Sandoz is called Omnitrop. It is qualified for the 505B2. The reason that this particular molecule has a lack of complexity. So for giving the equivalency data using the innovator clinical trial data is sufficient to prove the similarity standard. And finally, this particular 505B2 has been approved. So I'll give a few examples that how the 505B2 approved in different drug delivery mechanism, different dosage form. Mesalamine suppository, we all know that mesalamine tablets are there. Mesalamine suppository becomes the 505B2 route for the approval. Similarly, the asenapine, earlier it was available in sublingual tablet. Now, asenapine also got the transdermal system developed by Emax1 Japanese companies. Similarly, the betamethasones, available in the gel and cream form. Now it is available in the foam and get it approved through the 505B2. Midazolam nasal spray, it is a very recent example. That midazolam, we all know that it is available in the tablet. Now midazolam available in the nasal spray. So this particular product got the 505B2. Imagine that you are getting a nasal spray without doing the full-fledged safety and efficacy study of that particular molecule. And how much market you are going to capture that particular molecule, the huge advantages. Similarly, lovastatin extended release tablet, morphine supplet liposomal injection, doxorubicin's liposomal injection. Earlier it was in the solution form, then doxorubicin liposomal injection. The huge advantages on that. New formulations like paroxetin, mesylate, the combination product like carbidopa, levodopa, and entacapone tablet, levosalbutamol inhalations. Similarly, the deuterostatics, recent treatment and deuterostatics indications, that is also got the 5.5B2 route. So existing molecule, new indications, new delivery system, new formulations will give you the advantages like the new chemical entity. So it indicates that if you are able to extend that particular existing molecule in a different dosage form or the new indications or the new formulations, you will get the advantages like the new chemical entity, new molecules. What are the benefits? It is simplified the approval process because this is a molecule which is already proven its safety profiles. Only you are going to work on the efficacy part by changing the formulations or changing the delivery system. Safety already has been proven, so it simplified the approval process. Use of previously published studies, you need not to do full-fledged study starting from the investigational stage to the efficacy stage. You need not to go for the everything. You can use many of the published informations. Quicker to the market, you need not to spend like 20 years for the starting from the selections of the molecules to the efficacy studies. Maybe within 3 years time, 4 years time, so you will be in the market and you will enjoy the exclusivity of the 5 years. Lower cost, because you are not spending 20 years, you are not spending the huge clinical study, the product cost with improved efficacy will be the lower cost. And low risk, not like the in case of an NC molecule, 5% only success rate, 95% is the failure rate. Here in this case, it's reverse. 95% is success, only 5% is the failure rate. So the low risk, this is the huge advantages for the this particular 5.5B2 versus NDA. If you are comparing with the NDA, where the current most of the pharmaceutical companies in India, they are focusing with the only NDA generics. If I compare 5.5B2 versus NDA, what will be that? Branded generic to the market sooner. So if I compare with this NDA, this particular branded generics if you are developing, it will go to the market soon. 5.5B2 may qualify for the patent. So NDA, you may or may not get the patent for that because you are exactly copying the innovator product. So you may not get the patent for the what we are working now. But in this case, we are going to get the patent for the 5.5B2. Additional marketing exclusivity, like I explained in the previous slides, depending upon the type of clinical studies, type of the molecules, you may get 3 to 5 years versus only 180 days in case of first ANDA products. That the length depends upon the amount of additional data you require on that. I think that's all from my end. Thank you very much for your kind attentions. And if you have any questions, maybe I have a few more minutes to answer if someone wants to ask me.
Yes, thank you, sir. I request Professor Nagaraj garu to share his views.
Yeah, at the outset, Dr. Kapleshwar has done an excellent job of sailing us through the regulatory things. It was really a good compilation of the complicated fact of 5.5B. I'm sure that the young researchers and participants who listened through this section might have understood the in a nutshell what is this particular section is going to be. And there are many questions are there from the participants, and few of them we have put here. As many of the participants are from the academic fraternity, majority of them are the students of undergraduate as well as the postgraduate, and to some extent scholars, this is scholars, and also the young faculty. So what exactly is, what is this 5.5, this can be applicable for the herbal products? Can you make any herbal product and get this approval under this section?
No, this is only for the prescriptions product, prescriptions molecules, and where the particular molecule safety and efficacy already has been established. So here the idea is, instead of going for the full-fledged development of a new molecule, instead of going for that, the existing molecule, you can improve the efficacy of the product and still you get the same benefit like the new molecules. I'll give one example. For example, the paracetamol. Okay. Paracetamol already, Smith Klein BCM created the paracetamol market. Okay, as a new molecule they develop and they created the market like 500 crores market. Okay, suppose you come up with a paracetamol called as a first acting paracetamol. What will be the advantages? You need not to go through the same 10 years study what Smith Klein BCM did for the paracetamol. What you are going to do? You are going to do only 1 year study. Instead of 20 years, you will do only 1 year study. And Smith Klein BCM already created the market 500 crores. You are going to capture, you are not going to create the market. You are going to capture their created market. So you are creating a dosage of medicines of the existing molecule with improved efficacy and getting the advantages of like a new molecule, NC molecules. The reasons I am telling that in our Indian pharmaceutical fraternity, we have such a great capabilities we have, because we do not have the clear understanding what is called 505(b)(2). We know all the technical behind that, how to develop the new dosage form, but we do not know what are the regulatory pathway. If we are connecting that understanding of that regulatory pathway with our technical capabilities, we could be the one of the leader for the 505(b)(2) approval, the way we are the leader for the ANDA. Like, we can copy anything, any molecules you give to the Indian companies, they can do the reverse engineering, they can know that what are the formula, what are the process. Okay, that's the reasons we are pioneer of developing the ANDA product. The similar way, we have the capability of developing 505(b)(2) as well. I'll tell you, if you see the combinations product, India has most combinations product. You never find any other part of the world. Why? We understood that when we are going to the doctors never prescribe one medicines. They prescribe five medicines. Why I will buy five medicines separately? If I can develop combinations of the two, it will be a cost effective for the patient. So the similar way, there are different paths. Suppose, for example, I am taking a tablet. Suppose if I am an old person, so I cannot swallow the tablet. I can use the same molecule making a syrup. Okay, so that is called 505(b)(2), and we are very strong on that. So that is the reason I'm telling that if we are creating that type of understanding, starting from the college level, what is called 505(b)(2), when these students are coming out from the college, entering into the industry, they will apply that type of mindset in the industry. So that again, it will create the huge impact that Indian industries, India started developing the 505(b)(2) product. So that's the objective on this.
All right, sir. You rightly said what I wanted to say in the concluding remarks. I hope your lecture is provoking all of us, including me, to realign the research in such a way that at the end of the day, we should at least do something which can be, applicable for 504(b). And we do the research in academic level, as you know very well. M-Pharm is a part of 1 year is going to be the only research work. So especially Dr. Kapileshwar's talk, what I for last 45 minutes or 1 hour, and the three or four of his slides are very clearly shown what is going to be the advantage, how we are going to connect our research to this 505. Even in the closing remarks, he has mentioned that. So what I request all the young fraternity and the participants here, have a relook at your research work at the college level, and try to have a connectivity between this our work and selection of a project where, as he rightly mentioned, it won't take more than 1 year. So therefore, we can have a collaborative project, or we can have our own project, and where we'll at the end of the day, some meaningful project product is going to come out of it. I'm very thankful to you and also the College of Bapatla College of Pharmacy for making me this moderate this section. I'm very happy to see know that you are from my own college. I was your super senior. Yeah. So we have that I was really impressing me more than anything. So I thank the Bapatla College of Pharmacy, Dr. Satish, the principal, and other back staff working on this. And I now hand over the mic to Dr. Satish.
Thank you, Professor Nagaraj Garu, for your kind words. And our special thanks to Mr. Kapileshwar Swain for his very informative lecture. Most of us, including me, found it to be very new. Though we heard something related to IND, ND and ANDA, this particular section and its importance, especially the approvals which are done based on the type and the comparison between the various approval, whatever you highlighted was very, very useful for us. And young faculty members and the students who want to work for industry, they came to know about this particular section and its importance very usefully. On behalf of our college and behalf of Bapatla Educational Society and other associated organizations like Indian Pharmaceutical Association and Sri Padmavati Mahila University, we wholeheartedly thank you, sir. Thank you for your excellent presentation.
And it is my pleasure to associate with the college and university. And this is the way we need to give back to our societies, what we and again. And I always prefer whenever possible to what I am learning in my research career and the way the industries are moving towards the new era. It will be useful if I can share this particular information to my the fellow colleague and the upcoming students and my lecturers. So it is my pleasure to be associated with you people.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much.
Have a good day, sir.
Thank you. Bye-bye.